every shade, but believe me, this is warranted. This is exciting. This is all about Divine Brown, and I got to wish you a very, very happy afternoon, and thank you for taking the time out today to spend it with me. I am so enamored in your style and in your music. I just love everything you've produced. Now, I want to talk about Love Chronicles. That was your first album, was it?
No, the first album that I dropped was actually my self-titled CD, Divine Brown.
Right. Yeah. I would actually bring out a song with your own name on it. Believe me, it's a winner right there. But you have brought out Love Chronicles. Got to get mine. Old School Love, and also Dirty Gospel. Now, I want to talk to you about gospel. Are you, or have you been a gospel singer in the past?
Yeah, I sang in a few gospel choirs, actually. I sang in a gospel choir, I think it was about 14 or 15 years old when I joined it, and it was called the Lawson Ensemble, and that for a few years, and I loved singing gospel because of the... Well, like as you know, like a lot of soul music is steeped, is sort of based in the gospel world, and so I really learned how to develop. I think my voice really developed singing in gospel choirs. I also sang for the University of Toronto gospel choir as well for a few years. So, and those experiences, as well as like you know having different opportunities to sing in church, so. Those opportunities, like I said, helped me to develop my belting range, so that I could, you know, start to sound like my favorites, like an Aretha Franklin.
You know, I get that, I really do, and I've spoken to a lot of singers over the years now. And they say that if it wasn't for being a gospel singer, they wouldn't have the talents that they have today. So I get the basis of where you're coming from there, and I can see it today in your music that you bring out, especially in Love Alibi. I just love that. Really, really do. Now, you have, as far as I know, a 5-octave vocal range.
That's what they say.
Wow. You know, I sing tenor myself, or 12 miles away, depending how close people are. I could never compete with a 5-octave. I really couldn't. In fact, the shower doesn't like me anymore.
Oh, wow. That's not true.
Oh, I don't know. I really don't know, to be honest. But you're also a loving mother. Would you like to give a shout-out to your daughter?
Yes, I want to give a huge shout-out to my daughter, Tasia. I love you so much. You are my...
You know, that is just so special, it really, really is. And it is nice to meet Taser as well. I'd like to be able to pass on our congratulations to you and to Taser, and hope you're both going to be having a happy day over there in Toronto, Canada. Now, you're almost coming into summertime. Are you planning any tours around Canada and maybe the United States this year?
This year, I'm not 100% sure, but I know that I'll be doing some shows at, like, started off to be quite a busy year for me, more spot shows than actual tours, but I'm definitely going to gear into setting up some shows for probably into 2018, but starting in the fall, I'll be doing a few more shows here in Toronto.
Okay, usually in the wintertime or the fall, as you call it, I find a lot of artists are in the studios bringing out their next work, if you know what I mean. It's always nice to be able to talk to somebody who's touring at that time, picking up the dollars they're missing out on.
Yeah, there you go. I actually plan on recording just little bits over the course of the rest of the year. So the recording process isn't going to stop for me, and I'm hoping that I'll be working with some new producers. I'm hoping to meet some great producers. I'm actually, Love Alibi is being remixed by a really great house producer by the name of Terry Hunter. He's working on that, like, right now, and I'm really excited to hear what he comes up with.
You know, if you would love to pass that on to us as well, we would love to be able to play that, because believe me, we're such big fans of Love Alibi, and we are going to play that very, very shortly. We released that here on Valentine's Day over in Canada and the United States. It was the day after Valentine's Day that we had here. But believe me, it got such a huge response. We had to play it about a half a dozen times within the day, to be honest, which is unprecedented. It is unprecedented for us here to be able to do that, if you know what I mean. So, and I've got to thank Thornell Jones Jr. for not only passing on the Love Alibi track, but for putting us in touch with you as well. You know, I'm a big fan of my brother over there, you know, in that 30-mile zone called Hollywood. You know, we were talking to each other, and we kind of see you being at the 60th Grammys in New York. I think that's where you're going to end up there, getting yourself an award for that.
And fingers crossed.
Hey, look. Hey, look, we have already put our boat in. We have already. So I kind of think when you get that award on that stage, just remember, Grant told you so.
Okay. Keep that in mind, Grant.
Yeah, yeah.
Grant really told me so.
Yeah, yeah. DJ Grant from New Zealand. Yeah, hi to him. That'll confuse the rest of the world, believe me. It really, really will. Now, I want to talk about the Old School Love. Now, I just love this track. I really, really do. It was your first single.
Yes.
And what inspired it? Where did it come from?
You know, I that was a special kind of thing that just happened. I remember I remember my boyfriend at the time would ask me what. You know, who is that song about? Is that song about someone in particular? And I'd always say, no, not really. Like, it was, and maybe it was, but there's always, the inspiration comes from somewhere. And it might have been from a certain situation, but it was really about, it literally hit me. The melody of the song hit me. I was just playing around on my piano and it hit me and I said, oh my gosh, I have to develop this. And the gentleman that helped me to bring that song to fruition with programming and everything, James, he was really, really great at facilitating the ideas that I had. Because I had a really strong idea of how I wanted it to sound, and I knew it was going to be in 6/8, and you know, I kind of had the basics of the tune, and then it just flourished in the studio. It was just a really special moment.
Yeah, I really get that. Believe me, when I first heard it, I went, "Wow, this is a powerful first song." Especially when I found out it was your first song. And I've always wondered, when you put that together, was it about somebody? You've answered that. Did it take long to produce in the recording studios?
No, not at all. Like, it really, once we have the melody, the melody established, and it really, I mean, I feel like it took about an hour and a half just to sort of finish the song and know where it was heading. With the melody and lyrics and stuff, and then it really didn't take long to do the vocals. I think it was like a 4-hour vocal session, 4 or 5 hours, and it was done.
Your engineer must have been absolutely excited about it, being able to get out such a hit in such a short time.
I think everyone involved was really excited at the time.
You know, I can get that. I'm an engineer myself. I've worked in studios many, many years. And also live concerts and stuff like that as well. And with some very big names, by the way. But I get that. I really do. You know, it would just be an absolutely exciting song. So when I listen to a song, I listen to a song as an engineer would, if you know what I mean. Breaking down every increment of it. And I thought, you know, this is just a special package. So I got to congratulate you with that. I'm going to play it right now. Here is Old School Love. And Divine Brown, you're right here at Galaxy 107 FM.
It's funny how memories
bring
you back to me. just when I started to get myself together.
How are you feeling, Divine? You okay?
I'm okay. I'm a little warm myself, but I think it was just being flustered, like, being a little, like, about an hour off of what I thought we were going to do. So I was like, oh my God. Okay. So I'm still a little warm. I'm cooling down a little bit now.
Nice. I hope the temperatures are starting to warm up over there. I heard it was a pretty snowy winter over there.
You know what? It actually has been a relatively mild winter here in Toronto anyway. Other parts of Canada, I'm sure, have been more snowier, but Toronto for the past few years has been incredibly mild. I was out this morning and it was really beautiful. It feels like it's about, well, I don't know if you guys do Celsius or Fahrenheit there, but it felt like it was about 6 degrees here,
okay.
which is like anything. It's been really like unseasonably warm.
Okay.
And it's been above zero for like a long time. Like we might have one or two snowy moments and then it kind of takes its time and melts away. So we Torontonians appreciate that. When you get a break from the snow, we love it.
You know, I've got a girlfriend that lives in Grand Forks, British Columbia. And she's been shoveling snow so much that she's broken her snow shovel.
Yes.
And I'm going to tell her, move.
Yes.
Go to Toronto.
Because it's been so mild, it really has.
Absolutely. But yet again, I've always heard that Toronto is the music place to be anyway. Yeah. That's where there's a lot of talent coming out of that city.
Yeah, there's been a lot of talent here for a long time, but now, you know, with artists like Drake, who, you know, they're putting he's basically single-handedly put Toronto on the map. People have always been looking at Toronto, but him as, which I really appreciate, as a Canadian, he is always saying Toronto, Toronto. He's like coined the phrase, the six for Toronto. It's amazing. So we appreciate artists like him.
Cool. I'm just going to put you back to the desk again. You're right here at Galaxy 107 FM, and I'm joined by the lovely Divine Brown. Oh, my heart is racing, I've got to be honest with you. Now, to date, you've released three singles, Lay It On The Line, which we've played, and Meet Me At The Roxy, also Sunglasses. Now, I deliberately left out Sunglasses because I figured that Lay It On The Line was an important song. Same with Old School Love, and I just love that. I absolutely do. But I am going to play Meet Me at the Roxy. Now, I'm going to ask you a little bit about that very, very shortly. But we were just talking moments ago about Toronto being the focal point of what we think is R&B in Canada and is just making inroads around the world, especially with people like Drake, as you mentioned.
Yeah.
Now, what was the term you used that Drake uses?
Oh, that Toronto, he coined the phrase, the six for Toronto, which is short for the 416, our area code.
Ah!
Original area code. We've got a few of them now, but the original area code, 416, so... The six. Toronto.
Now I get it. And when I talk to Drake a little later on down the track, I'm going to have him on about that and say, Divine agrees. Yeah, she does. Absolutely. Now you also toured with a band, and believe me, I'm really fascinated about these guys, the Backstreet Boys.
Yes.
Way back in 2008, what was it like?
That was really cool. It was my
dancers, and we just had to. It was such a tight dancers, and I'm not sure if we had background vocals, but and it was just a tight 30-minute set. So it was just very. Everything was. It was my first experience touring in that way without a band, because I absolutely love working with bands on tour. But they were really, really great guys, really gracious, and we you know, the bunch of us had a fantastic time.
Very, very cool, because believe me, being a radio announcer, I have actually played their music for many, many years now and been fascinated with the band itself. And absolutely love a lot of their music, to be very honest. I admit it! I do!
But what I found fascinating about that tour was when I would watch, after we finished, kind of watch them perform, and the array of 16, like 12, 13, 15, 14, like 16-year-olds screaming at the top of their lungs with their mothers beside them screaming just as loud. it was incredible. It was a sight to see. I mean, the how loud it was so shrill that you couldn't talk to the person in front of you. You'd be like, but all you're hearing is like it was really an incredible experience.
You know, I think the Beatles set that precedence way back when, and it's gone on with every major good band in the world. I think they get that everywhere they go, and I can see that's going to be happening for you when you get on stage. All the guys are going to be up there doing the same thing, eh?
Hope so.
Well, I tell you what, when I come to one of your shows, I'll be in the mosh pit right there doing that, exactly that.
I love it. Thank you, Grant.
Now, what I was going to talk to you about as well is, have you ever thought about coming down under here to New Zealand and entertaining some of our Kiwi audiences?
I would love to, but I know nothing about making something like that happen. But if you were able to help me to make that happen, I would absolutely love. If you guys do festivals, I'm sure you all have some amazing festivals that happen throughout the year. I would be there in a heartbeat.
You know, I'm going to actually get Barbara, because she's the manager of Aurora Entertainments. That's the site that does all the live shows and everything up and down our countryside, even in Australia.
Beautiful.
That other island over there. as being a Canadian, you'd know the relationship between you guys and Americans. You know that love-hate thing that you got going on. Well, we have the same kind of thing happening here with Australians. You know, it's not their fault they can't win rugby.
Oh! And so it begins.
Oh, it does. I tell you what, we got the world champions. We got the All Blacks. They don't. We actually, the last World Cup, we set up a helpline for the Australian fans here in New Zealand. If you're going through withdrawals, you know, just ring 0800 1-0-1-0, 1-absolutely-nothing, and you'll get a Kiwi laugh at you.
That's so funny.
But it's true, we did it. Really. Yeah, but yeah. Oh, hello, we've lost you. Are you still there, dear? Hey!
Hey!
You know, it's not often that I see a pretty face on my screen. Usually I'm looking at somebody beardy. Yeah, it's me. But it's nice to have you back. Now, I also want to ask you about City Sonic. It's an interactive documentary that you put together. Tell me about that.
It was great because they were doing a whole thing about different artists. But what was great about that was getting into I love different styles of music. I love performing different styles of music. And what I did with them was I had an opportunity to do some jazz and showcase jazz. And they were talking about some of the cultural stuff happening within Toronto with different artists. So that just gave me and my viewers and fans an opportunity to see me. If you've been following, you know, some of my fans who've been following me from very early on before I became a recording artist have seen me do jazz music which is another medium that I absolutely love. And at some point over the next phase of my career, I will drop it, a jazz and blues record.
You know, we're kind of very, very excited about that because we understand different styles of music. Just it shows you how talented a person is. It's not just one single genre. You can fit into a lot of different scenes. And we get that with you. We really do. We understand. We really do. But I also want to talk to you about the Juno Awards. Now, you won that. And being the R&B recording of the year and singer of the year, how did it feel to be able to be invited to the Juno Awards and actually pick up the most prestigious prize?
For R&B Soul Recording of the Year in 2009, that was incredible. I felt like I don't know if you watched the Oscars last night, but I kind of felt like how Denzel Washington, when he was hoping that, and when my first album came out, I was hoping, I really, really was hoping that I would have snubbed it in 2005, but I didn't. I lost, or 2006. I lost to an artist by the name of Sean Desmond. And I remember seeing Sean Desmond and him saying to me, "I don't know why I won. You should have won that one, Divine." but it's okay. I snubbed it the next year. It was like how how Denzel felt when he didn't win for Best Actor for when he did his amazing portrayal of Malcolm X, and then won, I think it was the following year or 1 or 2 years after with a crime movie that he did. I can't remember the name of it, but it was sort of like that. But I was just happy to be recognized by my peers.
You know, I get that as well, because all my career I've never won an award, and, well, what do you know, I've actually won one now. So I absolutely understand that, I really do. But at the same time, the Oscars were a bit of a farce yesterday. Unfortunately, they named the wrong winning movie. They called it La La Land, where it should have been Moonlight. And also did a tribute to a lady who was still alive. Yay.
Yeah.
You would think of something of that caliber, they would have absolutely everything done correctly. But, you know, it's nice to see that there's a little fault in there every now and again. Makes my job
it's
that
funny.
Much easier.
Yeah, because they haven't had that level of a mix-up since, like, the 1930s or something.
Well,
1933, I think, was something like that.
Well, I don't know. I dispute that. They had Billy Crystal there once.
Messy. It sucked that it happened with something with a film like Moonlight, but like La La Land cleaned up. So I actually cried when I saw that Moonlight actually won Best Picture, because I know that I bawled when I watched that movie, and it was just so moving.
Yeah.
Really, really great film. Great. It was just shot really well, great lighting. Even though it was a low budget film, it deserved the award last night. Absolutely.
Absolutely. I got to agree with you 100%, but you know, I always look for the fluff ups every now and again, because it gives me something to talk about and have some fun with, if you know what I mean.
Absolutely.
My sense of humour just runs away with me sometimes, so please don't be surprised if I say something that might be a little outstanding. I'll take the admonishments later, I will. Believe me. But in the meantime, I want to talk to you about Meet Me at the Roxy. Now, tell me about the Roxy itself. Is it a particular place, nightclub, that you used to hang out with? And is the lyrics built on some life experience?
Well, what's interesting is that the Roxy, I didn't know there was a Roxy in Toronto. I think it was around in the 70s, and there were Roxys all over the world. So I did some research, but I didn't actually go to a Roxy until that album dropped, and we toured in Vancouver, and then I went into the Roxy just to be like, oh, there is a Roxy that's here. It's amazing. So I kind of took the concept from the Roxy that was in New York, that was huge in the 70s, and then I just put my own spin on it.
You know, I actually thought you were talking about the Roxy in New York. And luckily, it's one of the few places that I actually did visit when I was over there in my younger years, to be honest, was the Roxy. Had to do it, just had to do it. Wasn't old enough to get into some of the other nightclubs that were there back in those days, especially if you remember Club 54 and places like that. I would have loved to have been able to get in there and seen some of the superstars of that era, but I couldn't. But I did manage to get into the Roxy, and I was fascinated with the whole place, to be very honest. The people inside it, the people who work it, the decor, everything is just fascinating for me, especially being a country bumpkin coming out of a little place called New Zealand. You know, what an amazing place New York was, you know, back in those days, and can be today. I'm so pleased that Donald Trump's moved out of the area, though.
Let's not go there.
Oh, dear. That's almost like talking about ice hockey. Do you follow ice hockey in Canada? Are you still a big fan of Wayne Gretzky? I heard he owns his own team now.
Yeah, and he has his own line of wine as well. It's pretty good, actually.
Yeah, I couldn't imagine cracking a bottle of Gretzky. I just couldn't do it. Yeah. Merlot, maybe. Yeah, maybe.
It's not that wine. It's pretty good.
Okay, I'll tell you what. I'll have a chat to some of my friends over there, see if they'll send me a bottle, to be honest with you. But I also heard that he's doing quite well at golf. Maybe you can give Tiger Woods a few pointers now.
Ooh!
Well, you never know. Tiger might be ringing me later and abusing me. I don't mind. Yeah, you know, personally, as a golfer myself, I'm a branch manager. I play in the trees.
Oh, okay.
You know, so I could use the tuition as well. Maybe I'll be able to give Wayne a call as well. But I really want to talk to you about the Meet Me at the Roxy. Who was the producer of that?
That was produced by a really great producer here by the name of Slap at the Beat Child. He has a really, he's like a young producer artist with a really old soul. Like, his whole vibe was really steeped, is really steeped in soul music. So the collection of music that he has produced over the years has been very, very soulful. And his whole vibe is retrospective. And that was a lot of fun. We had a ton of fun producing that and recording that song.
You know, I get that feeling about it, to be very honest with you. And I think you've chosen some very, very poignant people to be able to bring your music out. I think it's been a targeted move, and I've got to congratulate you on that, because it shows in what's being produced these days, coming out of Toronto and out of Canada itself, especially with such an auspicious artist like yourself. Is it hard to find talented producers to be able to see you on your own level?
See, and it's interesting that you point that out. It can be. Because I'm the type of artist that already has a pretty solid idea. Like, once I develop the concept of what I want to talk about, sorry, I know you lost me. I actually am getting low on power, so I'm going to have to plug into a power source really soon, but I'll just finish the answer here. Usually it is hard to find the right producers who have either done their research on me as a vocalist and as an artist, or understand how I work. And because the explanation, it's one thing to say, look, I cut my teeth in live music, and this is kind of how I feel comfortable I also write, and this is the kind of style that I want to sort of work with. And I've deviated from that a few times, and it didn't necessarily work out. Like, I could do it, but didn't completely encompass who I am as an artist. Now, when I take steps outside, like, in the dance world, but do it from, like, sort of a house or just really soulful approach to the vocal anyway, that's always pretty, to a certain extent, calculated, because it's, I respect how the inspiration comes to me in the first place. So I just have yet to work with a producer who understands the entirety of my vocal range. I don't mean in terms of octaves, I just mean in terms of how stylistically, and to really be able to bring out those elements in the best way possible, to achieve, like, you know, the best sort of, the best sound that works for me. And I think that that's just like a real conversation with someone who has an understanding, a really, really broad understanding of music and loves different styles of music the way that I do. That would be the absolute perfect partnership, as it were.
You know, it's like a marriage, really, doesn't it? And you've got to come to the same agreement that this is the best thing for the work of art at the time. I really get what you're saying. I really do. So let me play that, and I'll let you go and get a power source. Here it is. Meet me at the Roxy. Here is Divine Brown on Galaxy 107 FM.
Isn't she just wonderful?
Oh, absolutely. Oh. I'm absolutely loving this. I really am.
What a talented artist. Wow.
You know, I get it. You know, I really get it. The answers that she's telling me, I get very, very much. I think she's such an intelligent individual that knows what she wants in her own career, knows where she's heading. Mm-hmm. And you know, I respect her.
Yeah.
You know, she's not listening to agents, she's not listening to promoters and stuff, she's listening to her, and that is important. It really is. I also think she's a very talented singer-songwriter.
She is, definitely.
And it's nice to know the backstory to a lot of the songs that come along. Especially stuff like singing with the Backstreet Boys, it must be fun, you know, to be able to have that in your CV.
Definitely.
And she's back, and plugging stuff in. Need to point that in.
Sideways.
Oh dear, I've lost the hole. Where is it going? Where it is? Hi, you're back. Sorry.
Adjust so that you can see. Yeah, I have to change the angle.
That's
okay.
So I can stay plugged in.
No worries. You know, it's absolutely lovely to have you a part of it. And I've really got to thank you for taking the time to talk to myself and all the work that's gone in between Barbara and Thornell and yourself. Thank you so much.
Listen, I really appreciate you guys having me on your station. I've been at this a long time. Now I'm an independent artist, and I really appreciate when people get my songs and just, you know, run with them because they genuinely like the music.
I'm just going to have to cut you off there because we're running out of time.
Problem.
Put you back to the desk. Here we go. right here at Galaxy at 107 FM and joined by the absolutely glorious Divine Brown. It is such a pleasure to have her here, and I've got to thank her for taking the time out of her day today to be able to talk to us here in New Zealand. And I'm just going to tell you, by the way, Divine, how many are hooked in right now? You've got 2,699,000 people listening to everything we say. You know, that's a big fan base. It really is.
That's awesome.
It really is. And by the way, you just met my wife. This is Terry.
Nice to meet you.
Hi, Terry.
Nice to
Although
meet
I
you.
I can't see her because Barb's... Oh, there we go.
Hi.
She does have pink hair. Yes, you're all quite right.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. Awesome.
Yeah, you got to stand out in this business, apparently. I do. Everybody loves my beard on radio.
Yeah, I know. Your beard works.
Yeah, believe me. Not so sure now that people can actually see me. I used to say I had the perfect face for radio once upon a time. Not anymore. but we are looking at doing more and more video and stuff like that. And I mentioned to you earlier on about Crank It Up magazine and doing interviews pretty much like this and getting it into the magazine. And we'd like to be able to talk to yourself and to the board to be able to forward your name and submit you into this magazine, because I absolutely would love to be able to do one more interview with you very, very shortly. Also, I want to know, is there a chance that you could give us your websites and everything that fans could come along and have a look at your music, download your music? Don't be cheap, guys. Pay for it. You know, artists need money. And buy all your CDs and everything like that. Would you like to be able to give us that information?
Okay, www.divinebrown.ca or .com to just go to my website. You can catch all of my social media handles there. It's Divina Marom, DivinaMarom on Twitter. And then, you know, like I said, you can catch everything else on, like, my Instagram, Facebook, all of that you can get once you hit up my website. My songs are available on iTunes, for sure, still available. The first album, Divine Brown, the second, Love Chronicles, my single, Love Alibi, is available on iTunes as well, including the, we've got one, an extended, the regular mix, extended mix, and then I've got another remix coming soon. I'm going to be dropping a slow song called Crazy Love very, very shortly on iTunes as well. That will be available, and I'll definitely let you know when that happens so that you can play it as well. I don't know if you do much slow songs on your playlist, but this one's pretty cool.
You know, we don't mind doing the slow songs. What we do is the good songs. We really, really do. And we have listeners out there, they're like connoisseurs. They just, when they hear something really, really good, they just won't leave us alone. They keep pestering us until we play it that many times. It's not funny. And I've got to say this, it happened with us here at Galaxy with Love Alibi when we released that. And believe me, even this morning we had an insurmountable amount of emails saying, when is Divine Brown coming on, and when can we hear Love Alibi? So we're going to be playing that next. Now, I want to actually talk to you about Love Alibi and your accompaniments there, 80 Empire. Now, tell me about those guys.
Those 80 Empire consists of Sir Digital, who is Lucas Reza, and Sir Analog, is Adrian Reza, the brothers, and they are, I've been working with them for a long time as well, for quite a few years, maybe 4 years, and they are such funny, energetic guys in the studio. Great, Lucas is the producer, and Adrian does all of the melodies, and the melodies, and they are just a great team. They're fantastic to work with, and I adore them. I adore them as people, and they're really, really good people. So I definitely want to continue my relationship with them. They're like brothers to me, you know.
I understand that, I really do. Now, the other thing I want to know is when you put the video together, was it hard actually getting those dancers together?
No, most of those dancers I've worked with before, if not all of them, one of the girls, I just called one of the girls and I said, look, man, I need it, because I had to put the video together in a very short span of time. And I asked her, can you, get in touch with a few dancers? We're shooting this video. Like, I think we had to shoot it in, my timeline was really quick, 2 weeks or something. And she was able to get it together. Thank you. Shout out to AC Mensa. And we were able to really, get it together quite quick. It was such a great, that whole day was really great, a great experience. And the video producer, a young guy by the name of Axel Villamil, who is just incredibly, we didn't have a lot to work with, but he's such a visionary that it really worked in terms of the choices of location. Like, we went straight to the heart of downtown, right at the corner of Yonge and Dundas, which is where the Eaton Center, the big downtown mall, the Eaton Center is. And we would literally run out into the middle of the street while at the crosswalk, while it was while we had, I think, 30 seconds, something like that, 30 seconds to kind of shoot. And then we had to be, all right, cut. We've got 5 seconds to run out of the street again. And what was great was the cars were really, cars passing by were parked or whatever, or waiting at the lights. They were very, very patient. I think we only had one
Yeah, that was probably me.
There you go.
Yeah, but I wouldn't be honking to be annoying. I'd be honking to try and attract some pretty girls. That's just me, though. I've adapted from whistling to honking. I don't whistle anymore.
Oh,
I'm allowed to put myself down. It looked like it was so much fun doing it. I watched the video a number of times now and have thought, that... can you hear me?
Grant, I think I lost...
Are you still there? Are you still there? Hello.
I'm hearing you. It just broke up a little bit.
Oh, okay. So we're back. I get the better deal here, to be honest. I'm sorry about that. as I was saying, it looked like it was so much fun putting everything together with that video. It looked like, it was one of those days where you could just pull one out of the bag and nothing could possibly go wrong. And I've got to congratulate you for that. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to play a Love Alibi. And this is the song that we premiered for you here in New Zealand. And I'm going to come back and we'll wrap this up very, very quickly. But I've got to say to you, it has been an absolute pleasure speaking to you this morning. I don't have very many pretty people on my screen, and you absolutely have taken it today. I really absolutely adore your work. I thank you very, very much. But in the meantime, ladies and gentlemen, here is Divine Brown and Lady Empire with Love Alibi. I love this. Can I speak in? Thank you, Divine. It is such a pleasure being able to do an interview with you today. And I got to really, really stress to you, I really appreciate you taking the time out to talk to us.
I appreciate you having me on the show. Thank you.
Look, we're huge fans. Huge fans.
Me too.
And
thank you.
The thing now is that now that you've been on Galaxy and have had an interview with us, you're family.
Awesome.
So we want you to come back and talk to us again. Let us know what you're doing in the future, what you're going to be releasing. We would love to be able to work with you in the future and bring out new music to our listeners from you, and maybe do a little catch up from time to time. How do you feel?
Absolutely. I'm going to be, I'm doing this soon, even though you guys are just dropping Love Alibi, so I'll make sure that I get Crazy Love to You in, you know, in a month or so,
That's awesome.
You guys can premiere it and play it and see if people like it. I was going to say, why did you, out of curiosity, why did you leave out sunglasses?
Because of time constraints, to be very honest.
Right.
At the end of the day, and I've got to be honest with you, it was a toss-up. It really was. It was a toss of a coin. And I looked at the amount of time between both songs and everything, because we are restricted by the hour marker,
absolutely,
if you know what I mean. So I chose the song Lay It On The Line over the sunglasses simply because of the amount of time that one fitted.
Oh yeah, no problem. I would have loved just to talk about that song because it had hit the U.S. Billboard Dance Charts at number 14.
Okay. Well, I tell you what, as we're wrapping up, let's cover that.
Yeah,
and
cover it quickly.
Yeah, let's just not leave that out there, because I would like to be able to talk about it as well, to be very honest with you. But at the end of the day, I had to make a decision. So,
oh, yeah, no, that's no problem. I know, I just was curious as to why, and if it was a time constraint thing, that's fine.
Yeah,
I wish I was able to, I can't remember the actual year that it hit number 14 on the Billboard Dance Charts, and my laptop is dead, so I can't check. But we can talk about that, because that was an exciting time.
Sure, absolutely. And in fact, I'll put you back over now. Here at Galaxy at 107 FM, it is 15 after 10 o'clock and 24 degrees. That's our high for the day.